Hello wonderful person, this is Anton, and today we're going to be talking about some really impressive achievements coming out of China once again. For the first time ever, they were able to develop the world's largest quantum distribution network. And it sounds kind of complicated, it actually is kind of complicated, but I wanted to help you understand what they were able to achieve and what it actually means for us in the future. First of all, as always, you can find the main paper for this in the description below, along with all of the other resources I'm going to be using in this video. But anyway, what exactly did China just achieve? Well, there was actually an article, I think about 2 months ago from when I'm making this video, in December of 2020, when it was actually reported that the Fermilab, along with the Caltech researchers, were able to achieve a long-distance quantum teleportation, which they reported as the first step to quantum internet. The paper for this, by the way, is also in the description below. And then China went, well, okay, hold my beer, Fermilab, because I'm about to do something much crazier. And within only a month, they released a paper suggesting that they basically achieved a network, a quantum network, of roughly around 4,000 or over 4,000 kilometers in length, connecting several major nodes on the way, along with an actual satellite attached to all of this. In other words, they sort of achieved what you could technically call quantum internet. But it's not really what's happening here, and that's also probably not the right term to refer to any of this, because the idea of quantum internet or even quantum computing currently doesn't actually have the same meaning as we think it does. Now, in terms of the quantum computing, I do recommend checking out the previous video I made on the other device that China created not so long ago, and this might actually help you understand of why quantum computing is not really the right term. It's a quantum device, but it's not really a computer. And so today I wanted to briefly talk about why you wouldn't really call this quantum internet either. It's a network, it's a quantum network, and it's a network that does use quantum mechanics, but it's not really internet as we know it. It doesn't really allow us to communicate using quantum mechanical bits or qubits, but it does help us with something extremely important. It helps us with security, and it helps us to the point where it might actually create a completely new system of essentially unbreakable communication networks. And in this case, it's really sort of a solution to hacking. It's a solution to the idea of someone eavesdropping on your password and being able to log in somewhere and, for example, steal your funds. And this idea of quantum cryptography is not new at all. Even back in 2004, there was essentially the first ever quantum cryptography bank transfer that was achieved by the scientists from Vienna University in Austria. And only a few years later, they also used a very similar principle in elections as well. And just like with quantum computing or quantum devices, the idea here is pretty similar. The main principle depends on various quantum properties of, for example, photons, and various principles of quantum mechanics such as entanglement. Now I'm going to try to briefly explain how all of this works in a second, but just to make some things clear, this is not really quantum computing per se. It still uses quantum processors, in other words, it uses something to generate these quantum effects, but there is no actual computing, there's no calculations involved here, and it doesn't actually make things faster or more efficient. It does, however, create opportunities for extremely secure networks where things become practically completely unbreakable, they become unhackable. And a lot of these quantum devices and a lot of this quantum network stuff usually works with lasers and properties of lasers related to quantum mechanics. Now, since the original discoveries of these quantum mechanical effects, we found so many different ways of exhibiting these effects in various particles and, of course, in photons as well. For example, entangling two different photons coming from a laser is basically second nature to most scientists today. It's something that today can be recreated relatively easily. But because it's quantum mechanics, everything here depends on the very famous uncertainty principle, which means that there is really no way for us to know two of the properties of two entangled particles at the same time. And when it comes to properties of light or properties of lasers that we can investigate here, the two that are usually used in this case are the spin of photons, which is also referred to as the spin angular momentum, also known as SAM. It can be either plus one or minus one, with the second property of interest being the polarization of light. In other words, we can know the polarization or the spin of light, but we can never really know two at the same time because of the uncertainty principle, which is also based on this formula right here known as the Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. And what this means is that if you were to take a laser and then use this laser to create entangled photons, or essentially photons that start behaving in a way where one depends on the other, you could then start using all of these properties to create some sort of a really interesting device that can use these entanglement properties for various security measures. Now, I'm actually posting this video right here that explains this in a little bit more detail how it usually works in terms of the actual physical properties. But one of the more common ways is to first entangle those photons and then send the entangled photons that are connected to one another to different locations. Specifically, one goes to the person that's going to be sending a lot of data, and one goes to the person that's going to be receiving a lot of data. But because the values in these photons are essentially either, for example, one spin or minus one spin, or polarized up, polarized down, we can use these properties to convert this to the typical binary code, zeros and ones. And that means that both the sender and the receiver can now collect all of this data coming from these photons and measure the properties, thus creating the binary code for the potential key. And so now all of these lasers are going to start sending this information, the entangled photon information, to two different people somewhere out there. Both of them should be receiving the same information though, because these photons are entangled. And this will then start forming what's known as the key. But because this key is based on the quantum entanglement from essentially these photons, it can really only be seen exactly by these two different people. No one else should be able to detect this key, and there's physically no way for anyone to know what these keys are unless they try to eavesdrop and try to intercept one of these keys. But because here we're talking about quantum mechanics and entanglement, it's important to remember that in quantum mechanics, once you observe something, it essentially collapses the wave of uncertainty, which means that by observing an entangled particle, or entangled photon in this case, it will suddenly assume a certain property and become disentangled. And because of this, it becomes physically impossible for anyone to eavesdrop on these so-called quantum keys. Now, these quantum keys become unique, they become only available in two different spots on the planet, and only two different people, or in this case two receivers, know exactly what these keys are. If anyone tries to eavesdrop, it automatically becomes sort of different, which means that it becomes impossible for anyone to try to capture these keys. An attempt to capture the key will instantly make both keys essentially invalid. And this process, known as quantum key distribution, is essentially what the scientists have been trying to work on for the past few decades. But at the moment, it looks like China was able to create something pretty mind-boggling. They created a quantum key distribution network that connects several ground-based nodes that you see right here with a satellite-based node that was actually tested back in 2016, with over 150 different industrial users across China. And according to them, this includes several different state banks, several e-government websites, and also a municipal power grid. In other words, they're making it actually useful and, to some extent, are introducing the world's first most secure quantum network that's able to transmit information without really the fear of being hacked. But is this quantum internet? No, not at all. As a matter of fact, the speeds that were so far reached here were only about 47 kilobits per second, which is roughly around 40 times higher than the previous achievement. 40 kilobits per second is basically what I used to get back in the 90s when I was on 56K. Some of you might remember the iconic sound these devices used to produce. And so in that sense, it's not really internet per se, but it is a useful tool for transferring these quantum keys. This is what we refer to as quantum key distribution. And once you transfer these keys, they can then be used to decode or encode certain messages that would use a classical route to deliver much wider information. So in more practical terms, this is how it kind of would work. By using a relatively simple laser-based quantum processor on both sides, we entangle the atoms and measure the entanglement features of these atoms on two ends. This will produce the keys necessary for us to essentially translate the messages. Once we confirm that these two keys are exact and that they're not hacked in any way, the sender of the message then uses this key to encode everything and sends it to the receiver. The receiver then uses the key they received through quantum entanglement to translate the message and get the result. Now, in essence, this is actually unhackable. There's really no need for passwords, there's no need for any kind of other types of security, because this type of a network, from a physics perspective, is in no way hackable. If anyone tries to eavesdrop on a password, it becomes completely useless, and both parties will then know that someone is trying to hack them. And because of these unusual properties, this, in some sense, can actually become the future of communication, banking, and even politics, elections, for example. In this sense, it's actually a lot more useful and, in some sense, way more reliable than any other previous technology we've used for trying to secure networks and secure various messages. So, for example, things like Bitcoin, which I myself still actually am going to use no matter what. And by the way, thank you so much to all of you that have donated Bitcoins over the years. But anyway, things like Bitcoin depend on this really, really complex security, using some extremely complex and very difficult to break passwords that, practically speaking, would take thousands if not millions of years to break. But these passwords are still breakable. Given enough time and given enough computational power, it's still possible to break any password. And that's where quantum entanglement becomes pretty much unbreakable and unhackable, at least for the time being. There's really no physical principle we know of where a message based on the entanglement of photons could be intercepted and still provide exactly the same message on both ends. So by having an observer of one of these entangled photons, you automatically break the password and it becomes unusable. But remember, once again, this is not quantum internet. It still depends on the classical route as well, where you're going to be sending the actual information that has been encoded using these quantum keys. So in that sense, it's actually a kind of a layer on top of the classical information method. We're still sending information using normal cables, but this information has been encoded using the layers coming from the quantum mechanics. But in terms of making all of this work and making all of this actually function, I think China currently is on top. I mean, for one, they found a way to communicate with a satellite that then actually can transmit this to other locations as well. And as you can find in the paper in the description below, they've also been able to achieve some really impressive accuracy ratings, suggesting that they're really getting close to making this useful in everyday life as well. Now, once again, this is not really quantum internet, this is more of a quantum security network, but it can help various organizations, in this case, for example, banks, to transfer a lot of secure information and to make sure that no one actually steals your funds, for example. So this is actually a type of a technology that a lot of people believe that will most likely replace a lot of secure communications that we use today. But we're not entirely sure if one day someone actually does find a way to somehow break this security as well. And although physically, or at least in terms of the laws of physics, we don't think it's possible, in terms of hacking, you never know. It seems that hackers have always found ways around all sorts of systems. But anyway, on that note, that's kind of all I wanted to mention in this video. It's definitely a super interesting concept, and it's definitely something that I actually personally am very interested in, and also have been actively studying this on the side. I'm not particularly good at it yet, but if you're interested in learning more about this as well, or more specifically, if you'd like to learn all of this completely for free, there's an amazing website set up by Qiskit, who also have a YouTube channel, but it honestly is kind of complicated, so maybe not the best way to start there. But they have amazing resources on their website with a lot of really easy to follow lessons. And so I'm posting this in the description as well, because you can kind of learn more about, for example, quantum key distribution by reading all of this stuff there. And if, like me, you also like to dabble in Python or any other computer language, they also have codes you can use to essentially help yourself to visualize all of this and understand all of this from the practical perspective. This is actually how I usually learn best as well. And though one day I'll probably turn this into some sort of a tutorial sometime in the future, for now, just go check it out yourself and maybe learn a few things as well. Anyway, on that note, well, I guess congratulations, Chinese scientists and Chinese researchers. You definitely achieved something that no one else has been able to achieve yet. But most importantly, let's hope that this actually leads to something very useful in the coming years. For now, good job, and check out the paper in the description below, subscribe if you still haven't, share this video with someone who loves learning about space and sciences, and come back tomorrow to learn something else. Maybe support this channel on Patreon or by buying the Wonderful Person t-shirt that you can find in the description below. Either way, I will see you tomorrow. Space out, and as always, bye-bye.